I tried connecting my ROG Ally X to an RTX 3060 graphics card, and I wanted to share with you everything I learned about it. First, I want to quickly go over the specs of this graphics card and why I bought it. This card comes with 12GB of GDDR6 memory, 192-bit memory bus, 15Gb per second memory speed, and 3584 CUDA cores. It has three DisplayPort 1.4a connections and a single HDMI 2.1 port. The maximum display resolution it supports is 7680 by 4320. Now, I'm not a computer expert by any stretch. What really drew me to this GPU was the price, $284 on Amazon, and the fact that it had over 3,000 purchases in the past month. To power the GPU, I purchased the Corsair RM750E fully modular ATX power supply. It was really important for me to get a fully modular unit, so I didn't have to deal with a bunch of cables I didn't need. Here are the cables that came with the unit, but I'll only be using two. It has a 120mm rifle bearing fan, which is designed to keep the noise down, which is going to be important since this won't be housed in a computer case. This unit also had a bunch of purchases. About 4,000 purchased this power supply in the past month. To connect the graphics card and power supply to my Ally X, I'm using the Peladn Link S-1 dock. It took me a while to get the Link S-1 once I ordered it, but there was good communication from Peladn in that they kept me updated on my order status. However, my Link S-1 did come with a build quality issue. It appeared to be coming apart in this one corner. This didn't seem to affect its performance while I was using it. And this might be just limited to the one I got. It connects to the Ally X via Thunderbolt 3 and has a transmission speed of 40Gb per second and will supply 60 watts charging. It will fit ATX and SFX power supplies. The Peladn also has a port that will support up to a 2TB M.2 2280 NVMe. I'm going to use a Samsung 2TB SSD to test if the port works. To get everything set up, I first connected the power supply to the dock using two small screws. After that, I connected a bracket to the power supply. This is going to hold the graphics card in place. Next, I plugged the graphics card into the dock and connected the card to the bracket. I'll be honest, everything didn't connect super firmly, but it was just enough to hold everything in place. I also installed my Samsung 2TB SSD. While I was installing it, I realized I didn't have a screw to hold it in place. It would appear that somewhere during the install process, I lost the screw that came with it, which, unfortunately, is not uncommon when I'm putting something together. Fortunately, I had a box of old computer screws, and I was able to find one I could use to hold the SSD in place. I didn't have any issues with the Ally X recognizing it, which I found out later after I installed everything. Once that was done, it was just a matter of plugging everything in. One PCIe cable connected the graphics card to the power supply, then another cable connected the power supply to the dock. I checked the connections by plugging in the power cable and turning on the power supply. I was pretty sure everything was connected correctly when I saw the fans on the GPU start spinning. Definitely a good sign. After I put everything together, I installed the driver for the RTX 3060 onto my Ally X. I went to NVIDIA's driver's webpage and searched for the RTX 3060. I downloaded the game-ready driver for Windows 11. After the download finished, I had to connect the graphics card to my Ally X to install the driver. For this setup, I'm using my HP Omen monitor. It has a 27-inch display with a 240Hz refresh rate and a max resolution of 2560 by 1440. I opened the file and went through the installation process. Once the driver was installed, I checked Device Manager, and sure enough, the RTX 3060 showed up under Display Adapters. I'm gonna show you some games running with the RTX 3060, but before we get into that, I think it's really important to show you how the Ally X performed without the graphics card. I set up the Ally X by dedicating 12GB of RAM to the GPU. I also turned off AFMF in similar settings to make sure I was only testing the performance of the iGPU. I ran the games at 30 watts in turbo mode with 1080p resolution at 60Hz. I used each game's built-in benchmark tool to compare the iGPU's performance to the RTX 3060. I first started with Cyberpunk 2077. At 1080p with default settings, the iGPU had an average frame rate of 23.87, which was playable, but not what I'd call smooth gaming. The graphics and resolution weren't as sharp as they could be either, so while it's functional, the experience just isn't quite there. I then moved on to Grand Theft Auto V. getting the results for GTA was a little different. After running the benchmark tool, I had to go into my files and find them in Documents, Rockstar Games, GTA 5, then Benchmarks. I found my average frame rate at the top of the page, which came out to around 30 FPS. And when I scrolled down, I could see my system and its settings. Despite the lower frame rates, GTA 5 still looked good and delivered an enjoyable experience. Forza Horizon ran really smoothly with the IGPU, and it was easy to get results with its in-game benchmark tool. With most graphics settings at medium, it averaged an impressive 58 FPS. In Mortal Kombat 1, the benchmark tool didn't give me a full breakdown of my system's specs and performance. It only showed the average FPS, which was 30 using the IGPU. While this frame rate might be a bit slow for serious fighting game fans, it still looked okay and it played well. Finally, with Black Myth Wukong, I had to go to the Steam store and download a separate app in order to run a benchmark test. The results of the benchmark test was really surprising. With graphics mostly set to low, it averaged around 75 FPS, which was higher than I thought it would be. For a game known for its visual demands, hitting that kind of frame rate made it feel really smooth, and I could definitely see playing through those settings. Does anybody know how to get past this werewolf? Okay, now that I've shown you how the Ally X performed without the graphics card, let's go ahead and connect the RTX 3060 so I can show you how the Ally X ran with it installed. I'm using the HDMI 2.0 port to connect the monitor to the graphics card. I went into Device Manager and disabled the AMD graphics drivers. I wanted to ensure that I was focused purely on the performance of the RTX 3060. We'll start with Cyberpunk again. As expected, after adding the RTX 3060, I saw definitive improvements in both graphics quality and gameplay. The game ran noticeably smoother, and the visual quality was much better. When I ran the Cyberpunk benchmark tool again, I was now seeing an average of 57 FPS at 1080p, and when I increased the resolution to 2560 by 1440, I was getting 45.99 FPS. Now, this might not sound like a huge boost, but I could definitely feel the difference in gameplay. Cyberpunk 2077 both played and looked much better. I saw similar improvements with GTA 5. At 1080p, my frames per second went up to 60. And at 1440p, my average FPS was about 74.6. In Forza Horizon, I didn't see much of a change in terms of frame rate. At 1080p, it reached 59 FPS. It was slightly higher at 1440p. Here my frame rate was 64. I saw a more substantial difference in my frame rates with Mortal Kombat. Here at 1080p, the RTX 3060 reached 57 FPS, and at 1440p, it reached an average frame rate of 46. Finally, with Black Myth Wukong, there was a substantial increase in frame rates at 1080p with low settings. Here the RTX 3060 was able to reach an average of 134 FPS. The increase in frame rates was not as much when the settings were changed to 1440p with high settings. Here the 3060 only reached 73 FPS. However, the graphics quality did improve, although my gameplay did not. Okay, I want to compare some more benchmarks between the IGPU and the RTX 3060, but before we do that, you see this overhead display with my game stats? Well, that can be activated from NVIDIA's app, so I want to go over some of the features of the app first, then I'm going to show you some more benchmarks. When I first opened up NVIDIA's app, I was greeted by a vertical menu on the left. The first section was the Drivers tab. It let me know whether the Game Ready driver was installed, and if my drivers were up to date. It also highlighted any recent updates or fixes. Next was the Graphics tab, where I saw a list of games compatible with NVIDIA graphics cards. Clicking on a game showed me the current graphics settings, along with NVIDIA's recommended settings for the best experience. There was also an Optimize button, which let NVIDIA adjust the game's settings automatically. I could view my system's global settings as well, although that option didn't work for me at the time I made this video. And if I wanted to start a game directly from the app, I could just click the three dots to the right of the game title, and it would launch it right from there. In the Systems tab, I got detailed information about my setup, and the Performance tab provided even more detailed stats about the GPU. There was an automatic tuner option that adjusted settings for me, and I could also manually set performance limits on voltage, power, and temperature. Although I do admit that part felt a little advanced for me. Under Settings, I could turn the in-game performance overlay on or off, toggle game filters, and switch on photo mode. There was also an option to automatically download driver updates, and I could scan for games on my system to add to NVIDIA's app. Plus, I could enable an option to optimize settings for any new games I added. Whenever I was in-game, I could access the quick access menu by pressing Alt-Z. This opened up a side panel with tons of options. There was a quick shortcut to the gallery to view my recordings, and I could also start and stop recordings from here. Clicking on the settings cog at the top of the quick settings menu opened up even more options. I could view a list of shortcut controls, customize my heads-up display, and adjust audio and microphone settings. I could also access video capture settings from here. Overall, I was really impressed by NVIDIA's app and all the options it offered. Some of the performance options felt a little bit advanced for me, but it was clear that this tool could be a huge help for anyone looking to streamline and optimize their gaming experience. Okay, I want to show you one more set of benchmarks. I ran the ROG Ally's internal GPU and the RTX 3060 through four benchmarks: 3DMark's Time Spy and Firestrike, Unigine's Heaven, and MSI's benchmark. I wanted to see how the internal GPU at 1080p held up against the RTX 3060 at both 1080p and 1440p. I first ran the Time Spy benchmark. I customized the settings to bypass the CPU test to focus exclusively on graphics performance. The IGPU did okay. It had decent scores and frame rates. When I connected the RTX 3060 and tested it again at 1080p, the scores and frame rates jumped. Moving up to 1440p with RTX, there was a bit of a performance dip, but it still held up really well. To focus on graphics performance on Firestrike, I eliminated the physics component, and the difference in results was pretty similar to TimeSpy. At 1080p, the internal graphics had decent scores and frame rates, confirming the IGPU is more than enough for less intense games. Adding the RTX 3060, though, changed everything. At 1080p, the scores really improved. Even at 1440p, the performance was still solid, but a lot lower than the RTX scores at 1080p. With Unigine Heaven and the Eternal graphics at 1080p, the score was on the lower side, but I got a really good frame rate. Once I switched to the RTX 3060 at 1080p, both the score and frame rate shot up. At 1440p, the RTX score and frame rates dipped, but was still higher than the IGPU. Finally, with MSI's benchmark, using just the internal graphics at 1080p, the score and frame rate was really low, but adding the RTX 3060 made a huge difference. At 1080p, I got a much better score and frame rate. Even at 1440p, it still held up well. Now, I've given you a lot of numbers, but I also want to give you this disclaimer. I'm not a computer expert, and I haven't verified the validity of any of these programs, so consider these numbers as anecdotal more than scientific, and don't make any buying decisions because of them. So, do I recommend connecting an Ally X to a graphics card? Well, first off, there are plenty of amazing videos out there from folks with far more experience using an external graphics card. So I definitely recommend checking those out if you're trying to figure out if this is right for you. That being said, I think most people will have a good enough experience desktop gaming with just the ROG Ally X. Although I didn't get great frame rates with the internal graphics card, programs like AMD's AFMF can boost performance enough to still make desktop gaming enjoyable. Personally, I had an awesome time running my Ally X with the RTX 3060. Gaming on a desktop monitor felt fantastic, and I got just enough of a performance boost to make it all worthwhile. Plus, the fact that I can eventually upgrade to an even better graphics card is a big bonus. Check out the links in the description below for more information regarding this project. By the way, did I mention I finally beat the werewolf boss in Black Myth Wukong? I'll see you in the next one.